What is up? Good Mic Work Commentaries, back at you with episode 453. I am your host, Greg Morgan. I would like to sincerely apologize for coming up a little bit late this week. I had all sorts of crazy work stuff and life stuff taking place earlier on in the week, and I just was not able to come up here on Wednesday like I normally do to make this commentary. And as a moderately successful YouTuber, one of the biggest rules that a content creator can have is picking a schedule and staying consistent to that schedule. I feel like I do that 90% of the time, but every now and then things come up and commentaries get postponed, so I apologize for that. By the time this gets up to you, it's probably going to be about Friday morning, so of course I'm here to give you your Raw and SmackDown reviews for this week, but since I'm a little bit late, I'm just going to be talking about the shows in general. I'll talk about the major angles and all of the key points, and there's also a lot of other wrestling news to get into as well. You'll hear my thoughts on JBL's departure from the SmackDown commentary team, Rusev's current relationship with the WWE and what his future might be, Raw going live on Christmas Day and New Year's Day. I'll give you a few words on the Mae Young Classic and Ronda Rousey's current involvement with the WWE, Jeff Jarrett's relationship with Global Force Wrestling, and Anthem Media's relationship with Global Force Wrestling, and maybe a few other news tidbits as well. So let's just jump right into Raw first here, not waste any time. Of course, last week we had the epic promo between John Cena and Roman Reigns. I gave my thoughts on that in episode 452. This past week on Raw, the two did have another confrontation. This one was a little bit less shooty than the one before. And John Cena actually opened up the show with a pretty good match against Jason Jordan. This is a match that I'm really glad that they gave to Jason Jordan, giving him the rub, putting him in there with Cena. And he gave Cena a good, like, 15 or 20 minute match, which was good to see. And Cena comes out victorious, of course, because he's not going to lose just a few days or a few weeks ahead of his match with Roman Reigns at No Mercy. He did eventually wind up AAing and pinning Jason Jordan for the win there. And it's kind of weird because this Jason Jordan being Kurt Angle's son hasn't even been relevant since they broke the story. I don't even know what the point of this angle is going to be. We're all thinking that eventually this is going to have to lead to a heel turn, or maybe it turns out that Jordan was lying about Kurt Angle's son. They're going to have to do something with this storyline eventually, but so far they haven't done shit with it, and Jason Jordan's just going out there every week and having matches. Some of those matches he's winning, some of those matches he's losing, and I'm glad that the WWE isn't hot-shotting him like right to the top, because as soon as he got there, we were all thinking he was going to face The Miz for the Intercontinental title at SummerSlam and probably win it. At least they're taking their time with him a little bit and having him work some singles matches with some big stars, because he's been primarily a tag team guy, you know, up until this point. So he's getting the experience that he needs in some of these big match situations. And eventually, I think WWE will do something with the kid. But right now, they're just putting him out there in random matches. Gave Cena a good match, came up on the losing end. Roman Reigns hits the ring after the match, and him and John Cena have a little back and forth again. And this one was a little bit better. Roman Reigns looked a lot better this week. I mean, he was completely annihilated on the mic by John Cena the week before. Held his own a little bit better this week. Made fun of John Cena for it taking him 20 minutes to beat a rookie. Called him a fake bitch again. John Cena barks back with some insults of his own, says that Roman Reigns is a conceited know-it-all who needs to be taught a lesson. John Cena even put over The Miz, which was crazy to hear. Talked about how Miz never gave up, and no matter how far he fell down on the roster, he kept fighting and kept fighting and built himself up to being a top-level talent because of his work primarily on the mic, and says that he respects The Miz for that, and he does not respect Roman Reigns. And then Roman Reigns says that he doesn't respect John Cena either, challenges him to a fight right there. Of course, John Cena doesn't do anything, and he just sits there, and Roman says that's why he doesn't respect him. So this promo was pretty good, I guess. I had no problem with it. Definitely not as many fireworks as the week before, but I thought it was still pretty good, and it still added a lot of heat for the match. And I'm intrigued by the match because of these promos that these two guys are cutting on each other. Eventually, you got to think they're going to come to blows one time before the big match in LA, but we'll have to see when that happens. Hopefully WWE won't do anything stupid like putting them in a tag team again together and having them team up or something like that. That's so old. I'm sick of seeing that. If they have any sort of confrontation again on Raw, I hope it's a run-in type of deal, or they're on opposite sides of a tag team. That might be better. But eventually you have to think all this shit talking is going to boil over before we get to No Mercy. So we'll have to see how that goes. As far as the match goes, you know, I talked about my early predictions for it last week. I'm still sticking with what I think. I think Roman Reigns will probably wind up winning this match. But I also don't think it's a one-off. I don't think it's going to be a one-and-done type of situation. If you look at what WWE is planning, it seems like they're building Roman Reigns for WrestleMania to take the belt off of somebody, probably Brock. So it seems likely that he's going to have to beat Cena along the way. But Cena doesn't usually just lose and go away. He at some point is probably going to have to get his win back, you would think, against Roman Reigns. So maybe they wrestle again later on in the year. They could do it at the very next pay-per-view. I doubt it. This kind of reminds me, I mentioned this last week too, this reminds me possibly of what they did with Cena and Batista all those years ago. Batista won SummerSlam and then Cena won Mania. So maybe they have Roman beat Cena here and then Cena beats him down the line, maybe at Rumble, Survivor Series, maybe a rematch at WrestleMania if they don't go with Roman winning the belt in the main event. And we'll have to sit through that shit again. So if they change things up, Cena could face Roman again and get the win. Or Cena can win this time and Roman can win the rematch. Who knows? But I seriously doubt this will be the only time these two guys will ever be in the ring together. This match is too big. So right now I'm going to pick Roman Reigns. It seems like Roman needs to get over this mountain if they truly are building him towards the title and they want to have him hold victories in 1 year's time against Braun Strowman and The Undertaker, retiring him and then beating John Cena, you know, and then maybe beating somebody else along the way and eventually going into WrestleMania to take the belt, then this is a match he probably has to win. But there's going to be a lot that needs to change. Otherwise, WWE is going to be in the same position at WrestleMania that they have been in the past few years. Last year, Roman, the heat was off of him a little bit because so much of it was about The Undertaker's retirement that even though the fans were pissed that Roman Reigns stood tall at yet another WrestleMania main event, I think most of our attention was focused on saying our goodbyes to The Undertaker. Where the year before when he beat Triple H, everybody shit on it. And everybody would have shit on it the year before that when he wrestled Brock had Seth not come and cashed in. So I don't know what WWE expects to accomplish here with Roman Reigns in this feud with John Cena. I've always defended Roman Reigns. I don't think he's nearly as bad as the fans make him out to be. The WWE's pushing of him can be annoying at times. Roman is not the best on the mic, but he has great matches. And just like John Cena, he can work with a lot of different guys and he busts his ass out there. And he does lose from time to time, despite what the fans think. Look at what Braun Strowman did to Roman Reigns. Braun Strowman owned Roman Reigns throughout the entire summer. Roman Reigns has not had a world title run since his drug suspension, and if he does win it at WrestleMania, it'll be close to 2 years in between his world title reigns. So this idea that he's John Cena 2.0 and he never loses and he's crammed down our throats is not really accurate because WWE is giving title belts and TV time to a lot of other guys other than Roman Reigns. But still, once the fans zero in on somebody, they're not going to let up. So if WWE is foolish enough to think that, oh, if he goes out there and has a match with Cena, everybody hates Cena, so if he beats him, the fans will start liking Roman Reigns. No, I don't think so. I don't think it works that way with these fans. I don't think they're going to see it that way. And WWE is going to have to do something if they don't want to have the fans shit all over WrestleMania again, just like they did at WrestleMania 32. So, you know, and you got to wonder about Brock, which I'll talk about here in a minute, and Brock holding onto the title potentially until WrestleMania, which I think is insane. If he holds that belt for a whole year and being such a part-timer, it sucks to have to not have the Universal title on TV week after week, and we've got another 6 or 7 months here to go if Brock does retain against Braun Strowman and go into WrestleMania to drop it to Roman Reigns. So WWE's long-term plans here will probably play into the outcome of Roman Reigns and John Cena. We just have to wait and see what WWE does. The match at No Mercy should be good. And let me ask you guys this. I've been seeing rumors about that this match could be the main event. John Cena and Roman Reigns. Now, don't get me wrong. It's main event worthy. It's WrestleMania main event worthy. But you still have Brock on the card. And Braun Strowman is a monster among men, like WWE likes to say 15 times every minute. And they've been building him so huge, and the world title is on the line, and Brock really is the biggest draw in WWE, the highest paid performer. Why is he not in the main event? I can't imagine Brock, of all people, getting bumped from the main event, especially when he's holding the world title. So that's a little shocking, but that's not something I'm going to complain about. I really don't care which match is the main event, but if I had my choice, I would still keep the world title as the main event. Unless they plan on having Brock just beat Strowman clean like he did to Samoa Joe and retain the title. If that's what's going to happen, then yeah, maybe the match needs to take place earlier on in the card and you can have Roman and Cena have the big dramatic main event with the fans struggling with each other. Cena sucks, Roman sucks. Let's go Roman, let's go Cena. I think the crowd involvement can be a lot of fun provided the LA crowd cares by the time we get to the main event. But right now I've kind of heard some stories that that match actually might close the show. So I'm old school and I feel like the title belt, unless it's a really big type of situation like Rock versus John Cena, or The Undertaker's final match or whatever. If it's something major like that, then yeah, you can bump the world title and have that match in the main event instead. But in this case, even though it's Roman and Cena, and even though it's a pretty big epic fight, I would prefer it if they kept the world title in the main event there. But speaking of Braun Strowman and Brock Lesnar, Brock was not on Raw, but Braun Strowman was. He defeated the Big Show in the main event in a cage match. Not a horrible cage match. You know, on paper it looks terrible, but it really wasn't that bad. Braun Strowman annihilated the Big Show, of course, and after he wound up pinning the Big Show, he picked him up and threw him right through the cage, and the cage broke, and Show fell down to the floor, and it was a pretty good-looking bump. And I guess from what the internet reports are saying, that this was a way to write the Big Show off of TV, because he's got to leave and go get some hip surgery or something like that. Not a hip replacement, I think it's like a minor surgery. But he's going to need to take some time off, so this was their way of writing him off. And that's a pretty big match for Braun Strowman to win on his route to his world title match against Brock Lesnar. If he beats the hell out of the Big Show and annihilates him and puts him on the shelf, builds Braun Strowman even stronger, if that's even possible, after everything he did to Roman Reigns and how he beat the hell out of Brock Lesnar twice at SummerSlam and the night after, and now putting the Big Show on the shelf, I really want to see the monster among men, the man that I share a birthday with, win the world title at No Mercy. I think that would be awesome. But early signs are pointing to WWE keeping the belt on Brock until WrestleMania, and I think that's crazy. I think there's still time to take the belt off of Brock and put it back on him before WrestleMania. It's only September, and after all of this build with Braun Strowman, you mean to tell me he's going to go in the ring with Brock and get F5'd and pinned after everything he did to Roman Reigns and all of these matches and all of this build to make this guy this big monster? The payoff is for him to get beat at No Mercy? You know, I think you at least got to put the belt on him once at this point. And Braun Strowman will be Universal Champion. Mark my words right fucking now. It might not be at No Mercy, but he will hold that belt. There is no doubt. For him not to hold that belt would be a travesty. So I'm really hoping that he wins the belt, but I'm starting to think that he's not. And I think I predicted that last week too. My early prediction right now is Brock walking out of No Mercy with the title. And that kind of scares me a little bit, because if he does, you know, who's left for Brock to face? Who can they put in front of Brock that you would think, oh, they might be able to beat Brock for the title? Some of us thought Joe would do it, and Brock beat him. And now you got Strowman. After everything they've done with Strowman, Strowman seems like the likely guy to win this match, but what if he doesn't? Who does Brock Lesnar face between now and WrestleMania? Does he have rematches with Braun Strowman? Does he have another match with Samoa Joe? Does he work with Cena, possibly? You know, what are they going to do with Brock between now and WrestleMania if he really is going to hold the belt until then? And I had a crazy idea, too. Remember last year, you know, they had the big match with Goldberg? He beat Brock at Survivor Series, and then he beat Kevin Owens for the title, and then dropped the title to Brock at WrestleMania. And a lot of fans were complaining about Goldberg holding the belt because he doesn't wrestle, and he's only wrestled a total of 2 minutes in 6 months, and somehow he's the champion, and that makes no sense. And I agreed completely, but I also said it looks good for the lineage of the Universal title when you look back at title history to have Brock Lesnar and Goldberg holding that belt. It's a brand new world title. They want to create some lineage for it, so you need some big names to hold it. So one name that came to mind was The Rock, and I have no idea. I'm just freestyling here. I'm just, you know, talking out of my ass. I have no idea The Rock's schedule, what his plans will be next year for WrestleMania, or what's going on, if he has any desire to wrestle again ever. But if he does, you would think it's got to be soon. How old is The Rock? 44? 43? Something like that? If he is ever going to get back in the ring for a big money match, it needs to be soon. He can't do this shit in 5 years. He needs to do it now. So maybe, just maybe, he comes back prior to WrestleMania and has a match with Brock Lesnar, and Brock returns the favor from 2002, and Rock is able to beat Brock Lesnar somehow, win the Universal title, maybe at Survivor Series, hold it for a couple of months, drop it back to Brock at the Royal Rumble, and Brock can still go into WrestleMania as champion. Or maybe Rock can be involved in WrestleMania somehow in a big match. Maybe for a title, maybe not for a title. I don't know. If they really wanted to do something fun with Roman Reigns and change things up and get the fans, you know, reacting to him a little bit differently, maybe they could have him do something with The Rock as well. You know, maybe The Rock could come out and say, you know what, you're an embarrassment to this family. I came out and helped you out at the Royal Rumble in Philadelphia, and I'm not used to being in the ring and having the fans shit on me. And I'm in there with you, and as great as I am, I can't even get the fans to cheer you if I'm standing right next to you, and you're pathetic or whatever, and the two of them have a fight. Or maybe there's a three-way or something like that. But if you get The Rock involved with Roman Reigns somehow, where he's not just kissing his ass and trying to support Roman, but maybe there's a conflict there and maybe even a match, you know, that might help the fans change their opinion of Roman. I don't know, maybe it won't. I just think that it's now or never for The Rock if he's going to get back in the ring and have any sort of a match or maybe even a farewell match. You know, like I said, maybe he's able to take the title from Brock, Brock takes it back from him, and then Rock has a retirement match at WrestleMania or something like that against somebody random. Maybe another match with John Cena. Boy, that would piss the fans off. But, you know, whatever they do, I think The Rock should try to come in here if he can and do one last program, one last set of matches with the WWE, and then he never really has to worry about coming back again if he doesn't want to. But me as a wrestling fan, I'm really not satisfied with the way that it ended for The Rock. I did not like that match at WrestleMania 29 with John Cena. I thought it was horrible. I thought it was so predictable. It was a pile of shit, and it wasn't nearly as good as the year before between the two. And of course, it was twice in a lifetime instead of once in a lifetime. And then we really haven't seen The Rock in the ring since. I mean, technically, he did have a match at that WrestleMania when he beat Eric Rowan, but you know what I mean? That doesn't count. He's got to be in there in a program with somebody major. You know, we heard the Triple H rumors last year. We thought that match might happen, you know, so maybe Rock can come back and work with somebody big soon, because I think he needs to. Whether it be Brock Lesnar or Triple H or Roman Reigns or somebody, I think The Rock should come back and do something and maybe even be involved in the world title scene on Monday Night Raw. So we've got a lot of time between now and Mania, but right now I'm a little bit nervous if Brock Lesnar successfully defends the title at No Mercy. Shit, he's going to hold that fucking thing until WrestleMania. And I'm just, I'm a huge Brock fan. I'm probably the number one Brock fan on the internet. I love the guy. I have no issue with him. I think he's an awesome draw, and I don't mind that I don't see him very often, but when he's champion, it keeps the belt off of TV, and that bothers me a little bit, and I don't really want to see that happen for very long. 5 title defenses in a year is just not enough for me, so I'm hoping that whatever they do with Brock Lesnar, it keeps the Universal title is on Raw as much as possible. So I would love to hear what you guys think about the whole Braun Strowman and Brock Lesnar match. Who do you think is going to win that? What do you think their plans are going to be for Brock going into WrestleMania? Is he really going to hold that belt all this time for an entire year? But I'm holding out hope and keeping my fingers crossed that they will put the belt on Braun Strowman. And Strowman doesn't have to hold it forever. I mean, maybe he will. I mean, after he owned Roman Reigns during the summer, maybe Roman Reigns gets the big victory back at WrestleMania against Strowman. Maybe Brock works with somebody else. Maybe Brock's not even champion. Maybe Strowman takes the belt from Brock, runs with it until Mania. Roman gets his rematch and beats Braun Strowman at WrestleMania, getting his victory back, winning the world title in the main event. Yeah, the fans are going to fling feces into the ring, so I'm not saying I want that to happen. I'm just saying that might be what the WWE's plans are. So give me all your scenarios in the comments below and let me know what you think. As far as what else we saw on Raw, the only other major match that took place was the Intercontinental title match between The Miz and Jeff Hardy. Jeff Hardy won that Battle Royal last week to earn this title shot, and The Miz pretty much beat him clean. The Miztourage and Matt Hardy were getting involved initially. They were all ejected from ringside by the referee, and The Miz wound up countering a twist of fate into the skull-crushing finale for the pin. It was actually a really good finish and a good solid victory for The Miz retaining the Intercontinental title. Part of me thought they might put the belt back on Jeff. The fact that they were giving him this title match to begin with makes me think that maybe they might be looking for a final singles run for Jeff. And whatever's going on with Matt and the broken characters, Matt's only chance for success, I feel, in the WWE is to be able to be a version of that broken character. Whether he's full broken or whether he's woken or whatever the fuck they do, he's got to be sort of like he was in TNA for the WWE fans to care about him. Jeff, on the other hand, has always been hugely popular and hugely over with the WWE audience, and he's a big merchandise seller. So maybe WWE wants to get Jeff back in the mix and potentially give him some title belts. So we'll have to see what happens with Jeff in the future. But his first initial title match back in the WWE came up unsuccessful, and The Miz got the win, and it was a pretty solid win for The Miz. They set something up backstage where Nia approaches Kurt Angle, and she's all pissed off about Sasha getting a title shot before her, because Nia won a big match last week, I think, to put her in contention for the title. And then Emma comes in talking about Twitter again and bragging about hashtags or some shit like that. And Kurt Angle decides to make a tag team match with Nia teaming up with Emma. And they would be taking on Sasha Banks and Alexa Bliss, who were being forced to team up. And the stipulation was that if Nia Jax and Emma win that match, they will both be inserted into the title match and it will become a fatal four-way. They wound up winning, so Emma and Nia Jax are now a part of this title match. And I don't expect to see a title change, especially since Alexa just won it back. We've seen a lot of hot potatoing with that belt. Sasha Banks herself has gone on interviews and said that she doesn't understand why they give her such short title runs. It seems like WWE does it on purpose just to fuck with her. So I don't know what the deal with that is. But if they have a fatal four-way next week and Alexa drops the belt, it's like, Jesus, can somebody hold on to this thing more than a few days, please? We had Enzo, Grand Metalik, and Cedric Alexander winning a six-man cruiserweight match on Raw. And on 205 Live, there was a fatal five-way number one contender match, which Enzo won. Fuck me. So he's going to go into No Mercy to take on Neville for the cruiserweight title. That's fine. Whatever. Enzo just got there. He was presumably put there to help breathe some life into 205 Live. So giving him a title shot is something that I kind of understand. But damn, you mean to tell me, you know, he just can't win. I fucking refuse. I flat out refuse. You know, if he wins, I will say, not my champion, just like people say, not my president about Trump. I will fight this thing tooth and nail. Neville is too good and too awesome and a hell of a lot better than Enzo. And it just wouldn't be believable. After everything that Neville has done and everybody that he's mowed through, and he's been so dominant, he had that one little hiccup with Tozawa, but for the most part, he has beaten everybody. Enzo cannot be the guy to dethrone Neville. He can't. I fucking refuse. Hopefully that match will be on the No Mercy kickoff show and Neville will beat Enzo in 13 seconds. We had a Finn Balor promo and then Bray Wyatt came up on the Tron and they exchanged some words back and forth. They're having a match, of course, at No Mercy, so nothing really newsworthy coming out of that promo. It was just a furthering of the storyline between those two. And I guess this might be the blow-off. They could do one more after this, but I would hope that after No Mercy, these two guys are done. And Balor can start, you know, getting in some title contention somewhere, whether it's IC title or whether it's world title. I don't even know who The Miz is programmed to work with right now off the top of my head. It's escaping me, but I'm hoping that when Balor is done with Wyatt, maybe he can move on and challenge Miz for the title. I think Finn Balor or even Seth Rollins or somebody like that would make a really good babyface Intercontinental Champion. I'm ready to see it. The Miz has held it for a while. He's been retaining it and been successful in some of his title defenses, but if he runs into Finn Balor, I want Finn to beat him. Speaking of Seth Rollins, him and Dean have a title match at No Mercy against Sheamus and Cesaro. Sheamus and Cesaro beat Heath Slater and Rhino on Monday Night Raw. Dean and Seth were on commentary for that. Dean and Seth would later have a match against Gallows and Anderson, which they would win when Sheamus and Cesaro are on the outside of the ring trying to interfere. That causes a distraction for Carl Anderson, and he gets rolled up and pinned. And after the match, the club starts fighting with Cesaro, and Sheamus and Cesaro kick their asses and stand tall. So I'm not sure if WWE's going to flop the titles back at No Mercy. Probably not. I would like to see Seth and Dean hang on to the titles maybe just a little bit and then do the heel turn with Dean Ambrose, you know, maybe a month later. Not quite ready to see it yet, but you got to think it's got to be on the horizon at some point whenever these two guys drop the belts. And as big of a fan as I am of Sheamus and Cesaro, as far as the No Mercy match goes, I'm kind of rooting for Seth and Dean to keep the belts there. That's pretty much all I have written down for Raw. It wasn't the greatest show. You know, we had the furthering of the storyline between John Cena and Roman Reigns, which wasn't bad. The cage match was not horrible. But other than that, it was just your typical mediocre Raw with a title match sprinkled in there with The Miz beating Jeff Hardy. So, decent show, not great. I think SmackDown was much better. Speaking of SmackDown, let's move on to that. JBL is gone from the SmackDown Live commentary team. Twitter was celebrating their balls off when this news was announced earlier this week. I could not be happier. There was a time when I didn't mind JBL on commentary. I never really disliked the guy, even when he had so much heat during his heel run back in the 2000s when he beat Eddie Guerrero for the title and he was goose-stepping at house shows and shit like that. I even had his back then. But eventually, this guy just got so fucking annoying on the mic. He blocks everybody on Twitter. I didn't even say one single thing negative about him. I never insulted him, never said shit about JBL. And he blocked me. What a dick. And I think he blocks everybody. So for a big, rough and tough Texan tough guy who's a bully backstage, he is the biggest social media pussy walking planet Earth. So the fact that this guy is gone and his annoying commentary is gone is something that I am not going to shed a tear over. I am ecstatic about that. Apparently he's leaving to go concentrate more on his charity that helps underprivileged kids. So good for him. That's a great cause, and I'm happy that he's doing that, and I'm happy that he's spending more time on that. He will still be popping up from time to time. His relationship with the WWE is not over. He will remain in the family. He'll probably appear at WrestleMania and big pay-per-views and maybe even do guest commentary spots. At some point, he's probably going to go into the Hall of Fame, maybe even this year. It's very possible. But at least we don't have to hear his annoying fucking voice on SmackDown every week. Everybody hates him. Nobody likes him. Nobody. Nobody fucking likes JBL. So I was laughing my ass off when I was reading Twitter when this news was announced. People were just jumping for joy. Giddy as a schoolgirl over this news. So JBL, good riddance. Good luck to you. You know, I'm definitely not going to shit on your cause. It's a great cause. And I'm glad that you're taking time off to do charity. Or at least that's what he's saying he's doing. But the fact that he is gone is definitely not something I am going to lose sleep over. But the decision on who his replacement was going to be, I do disagree with. Now, I love Corey Graves. I'm a Corey Graves supporter. A lot of people don't like Corey. I do. I think he's a modern-day Jesse Ventura. I like his commentary. I like the way that he seems fearless out there, and he'll say anything, and he'll try things, and he's just a nice breath of fresh air. We have not had a commentator like him in a long time. You know, he has a true identity. He sets himself apart from the others. Byron Saxton is so bland and so generic, and there's nothing special about his voice, and there's definitely nothing special about his look. Tom Phillips, same way. Tom Phillips is a very good announcer, very good commentator, but he doesn't set himself apart, and the announcers don't need to steal the spotlight from anybody, but you have to have some personalities out there. And you used to have that back in the day with Gorilla Monsoon and Bobby Heenan and Jesse Ventura, and we really haven't seen that in many, many years. We've had our great play-by-play guys, you know, Jim Ross being the voice of WWE for all of those years. Jerry Lawler, at times, was an excellent co-host for Monday Night Raw. Paul Heyman was pretty good back in the day as well, but, you know, we just haven't really had anything. The commentary team has been kind of stale in the past few years, and I think Corey Graves adds something different. So I'm pro Corey Graves, and I like him, but I disagree with him being on SmackDown. This is a brand extension. These two brands, SmackDown and Raw, are supposed to have different identities. Remember when I was complaining a year ago when they first announced the brand extension, and I was very concerned that neither show was going to feel different because they were probably going to keep the same set and do the same shit, and everything was going to look the same except on one show the lights would be red and on the other show the lights would be blue. But they did actually change it up a little bit. SmackDown did feel a little bit different. The commentary table is at ringside on Raw. It's back on the stage. The sets are slightly different, still very similar, but there is differences between the two. And the commentary teams were different, and one show was 3 hours and one show was two. So I guess WWE did the best they could to make these brands feel different. But with the commentary teams, I think they need to remain different too. To me, it doesn't make any sense if you have to have this, you know, imaginary competition between the two shows. You can't have a commentator doing both, because whose side is he going to be on? Is he going to be pro SmackDown and anti Raw on Tuesdays and pro Raw and anti SmackDown on Mondays? How the fuck is that going to work? Unless he's going to be involved in storylines. It's very possible. I've said right from the start that whatever they wind up doing with Jason Jordan and Kurt Angle, that Corey Graves might be involved, because he was the first person to show Kurt Angle those text messages, and he was walking away from the commentary booth a couple of times on Raw and getting involved in storylines. Now he's over on SmackDown. Maybe he can get involved with Chad Gable, and maybe there's more to this story than meets the eye here. But the decision to put Graves on SmackDown, I kind of disagree with, because I think SmackDown commentary team should be completely different from the Raw commentary team. You know, but with that being said, who was there really to replace? I mean, Corey Graves really was the only option. They could have done Nigel McGuinness, I guess. David Otunga is still floating around. God forbid they brought Lawler back in. He's probably their best option, but still, having a guy on both Raw and SmackDown, I am not a huge fan of that. But that's beside the point. There's really nothing I can do about that, so why don't we just talk about the show? Now, the big story of the show, we had the number one contenders match between Randy Orton and Shinsuke Nakamura, which I'll talk about in a minute, but probably the biggest news to come out of SmackDown is what took place between Kevin Owens and Shane McMahon. Now, this was a pretty good promo between these two. There was a match, I believe it was a women's match, right? Carmella and James Ellsworth are in the ring cutting a promo. She's about to have a match with Natalya. Kevin Owens comes out and says, hey, guess what? I'm going to be the guest referee for your match with Natalya. And he demands that the referee take his shirt off so Kevin Owens can wear it and ref the match. That prompts Shane McMahon to come out, and he says, hell no. A promo ensues between the two, and it gets a little bit personal. And Owens at one point mentions Shane McMahon's sons and his family. And Shane warns him, hey, if you mention my family again, you know, I'm going to fucking kill you. And then Owens talks a little bit more shit and then delivers the line about the helicopter crash, which I found fascinating. I couldn't believe he said that. But, you know, Shane was involved in the helicopter crash a couple of weeks or a couple of months ago and luckily survived. And Kevin Owens said that his family would have been better off if he didn't survive that crash. Kind of crazy to hear that in today's day and age of the PG and PC world of WWE. Back in the day, you know, Randy Orton used to say, tell Rey Mysterio that Eddie Guerrero was in hell and then drive his lowrider through the set. And we saw what Becky Lynch, or who was it? Who the fuck was that? Who made the comment? It was Paige, right? Somebody made a comment about Reed Flair in their program with Charlotte, you know, a year or two ago or whenever that was. So WWE sometimes goes there, and generally, whoever says these things gets a shit ton of heat. But Kevin Owens is the one talent that I think can get away with this. And it wasn't that bad. I mean, it was a helicopter crash. It's not like somebody died and he was making fun of it or anything like that. But it was still a line that I was kind of surprised to hear. So once Kevin Owens mentions Shane's kids again, Shane completely snaps, beats the shit out of Kevin Owens. They're brawling all on the outside of the ring, and Shane just beats his ass over by the commentary table. And Daniel Bryan is freaking out, and he approaches Shane, and Shane's like, I know, I got out of hand, I lost control. And Daniel Bryan's like, you can't be doing that shit. Later on, Daniel Bryan is in the back dealing with the Usos and the New Day. They're going to have another tag team match, and the Usos get to pick the stipulation for that. That match is going to happen next week on SmackDown. I believe it's in Las Vegas for the title. And the Usos informed the New Day that it would be a street fight. So that's going to be the title match that we get next week. Right after that promo is when Vince McMahon calls Daniel Bryan on his phone, says something to Daniel Bryan. Daniel Bryan says, okay, I'll go out into the ring and do it right now. He goes out there after the commercial break, calls out Shane McMahon, and says, hey, your dad just called, and he's informed me that you are indefinitely suspended. So Shane McMahon, I guess, is going to be taking some time off, or maybe just being off of TV for a little while here until Hell in the Cell. And also that Vince McMahon is returning to SmackDown next week to make some sort of an announcement. I have no idea what that announcement is. I don't think it's anything earth-shattering. It's probably just something pertaining to Hell in the Cell. And you would think now that they've kind of intensified the heat between Shane McMahon and Kevin Owens making it personal, talking about Shane's kids, and talking about the helicopter crash, they are trying, it seems to me anyway, that they are trying to build enough heat that would warrant this match being in a Hell in the Cell. So we might only wind up getting one cell match at the Hell in the Cell pay-per-view, and it's probably going to be Kevin Owens versus Shane McMahon. I don't know if that's going to be Vince's announcement or if he's going to announce something else. I don't know, but if I had to guess, it's probably just going to be pertaining to Hell in the Cell, and I don't think that Vince McMahon is really going to drop any bombshell on the fans. They're going to tease it like it's a big deal because they probably want to spike a good rating for this show. And Vince coming out generally equals ratings, especially when he's not been seen on TV in a while. So he'll be on SmackDown next week in Las Vegas. And I guess we'll just wait and see what he has to say there. The big main event, of course, like I said, was Nakamura taking on Randy Orton. This was a match I was really interested to see. I was really interested in the Nakamura-Cena match, but I thought Randy Orton and Nakamura might even be a little bit better. In my head, I was envisioning Randy Orton working with Nakamura's style a little bit better than Cena. And Randy Orton can be very smooth and very athletic, and I think the two of them can have a good match together. They did. Really fun spots in this match, including the two counters to the RKO. The first one was when Randy Orton jumped up to do the RKO, and Nakamura beautifully countered it right into an armbar submission. It looked fabulous. And the fans were even like, holy shit, I marked out for that spot. And the final one was when he countered the RKO into like a backcracker or whatever it was, and that set up his finisher. And he hit Randy Orton with the kick and pinned him 1-2-3 and is a number one contender again for Jinder Mahal's title. So Nakamura's title matches have come as a result of him winning number one contender matches against John Cena and Randy Orton, arguably the two biggest stars in the WWE in the last 15 years. So I said when he first challenged Jinder Mahal at SummerSlam for the title that he probably wouldn't win it there, but not to panic because he's probably going to get another shot. We should know this by now as fans. So many fans were freaking out that he lost and they wish that he would have won. I'm like, chill out. When do you see one and done matches? When do you see one-offs? Extremely rarely. And you're definitely not going to see it with two current roster members that are on TV every week. So I knew that Nakamura would get another title shot against Jinder Mahal in the future. It was pretty predictable that he was going to win this match because Randy Orton just worked with Jinder Mahal all summer long. They had like three pay-per-view matches in a row together. So for him to get another title shot at this point at Hell in the Cell seemed strange, especially after they've already done the Punjabi prison match and all that shit. So I figured Nakamura would win. Randy Orton did the honors, put him over, and hopefully now we can start talking about a title change because, you know, I can see WWE continuing on with Jinder Mahal. I think they're somewhat satisfied with his title run, probably not as satisfied as they were hoping to be, but Jinder has not been all bad. He's been a decent character. He's not horrible on the mic. He can work a little bit, but he's still not my favorite, and he's still not a lot of the fans' favorites. So now that he's held that belt for a little while and he's already survived one match with Nakamura, now we can start talking about title change. So I'm not sure at this point. I'll wait and see how the build goes and how their feud goes on SmackDown in the next couple of weeks, and I'll make a more accurate prediction hopefully. But right now I'm kind of hoping Nakamura takes the title from him. I want to see Shinsuke win that belt. To me, it was just timing. You know, to me, WWE put all that time and energy in making this new star in Jinder Mahal. I didn't see them really taking the belt off of him right away, like after 2 months. I would think he would have to hold it for 4 or 5 or even 6 months until he lost it. So now it's been a while. He could potentially drop it in any time, and maybe that time will be Hell in the Cell. We'll have to wait and see. We also had the re-debut of Dolph Ziggler, if you want to call it that. He's cut a couple of promos recently on SmackDown saying that he's going to come back out with this new look and this new music and all these new sparkles and this new outfit and all this shit. He comes out there as normal Dolph Ziggler, cuts a promo, and he goes, oh, what, this isn't what you wanted? And he goes back behind the curtain, comes back out as John Cena. John Cena's music plays, and Dolph Ziggler does his whole entrance, and then he cuts a promo, and then he leaves again, comes back out as Randy Savage with Randy Savage's music, and then he cuts a promo after that. And then the third and final one was the best. He comes out as Naomi and does Naomi's entrance and dances and slides down the ramp like she does, and then cuts a promo and leaves. So he basically just told the fans to go fuck themselves. Nobody is better than he is in the ring, and he doesn't need all these flashy entrances and everything to prove that he's great. But for me, as entertaining as I found that segment, especially when he came out as Naomi, I think it really fell flat, and it's not going to amount to anything. I think Dolph Ziggler is dead in the water. I think the guy's great. I think he's awesome in the ring. I don't understand why things have never worked out for him. Last year, it looked like he was turning the corner. He was working with The Miz. They had a great feud and a great match. I think it was at No Mercy, actually, last year. And there was some great promo work involved, and Dolph Ziggler even put his career on the line at one point, and it seemed like maybe he was getting over the hump, but once he won the title and then dropped it back to The Miz, he was right back to eating shit again. So, you know, Dolph Ziggler, I can't imagine this guy re-signing again. So whatever his contract situation is, he needs to get the fuck out of WWE and go work somewhere. Go work Japan. Go work Global Force Wrestling if they're still in business. Go work Ring of Honor. Go work the indies. Look at how well it's worked out for guys like Cody Rhodes. There is money to be made out on the indie scene, especially right now, because independent wrestling is as popular as probably it's ever been, you know, maybe even since the early 90s or something. So, you know, there is life outside of the WWE for the first time in a long time. And I think talents like Dolph Ziggler would be very well suited to leave WWE, and they can probably have some success. So it sucks. I don't know what's going to happen with Ziggler now. If he's going to come out on SmackDown and have more matches or go on a winning streak or get a title shot or whatever the hell he's going to do, I don't know. But it seems like WWE is just killing time and maybe even fucking with him a little bit, making him do all these silly entrances as Cena, Savage, and Naomi. So I guess we'll see what Dolph Ziggler does next week. Speaking of people like Dolph Ziggler, I'm getting a little bit nervous for Sami Zayn. He lost a match to Aiden English. I'm fine with him trying to push Aiden English. He needs to get some victories, and he's got to beat somebody. And Sami is a pretty credible opponent. But Sami's been on kind of a losing streak lately. And I think changes might be in order for Sami. Changes might be needed. Otherwise, I fear that he will become like Dolph Ziggler, and he will be buried so far, there's no coming back from it. So hopefully these losses, they will wind up turning this into a storyline. I've heard some fans say that they want him to come back and wrestle as El Generico. That would be cool. Sami Zayn, I don't know if he could pull off a heel turn or not, but maybe Sami could go heel. Maybe Sami could team up with Kevin Owens and form a relationship with Owens like Jericho did or something, just to put him with a top guy that gets over and is good on the mic, and, you know, Sami can get a rub from. Sami shouldn't need a rub from anybody. He's awesome in the ring. Fans, from what I have seen, have always respected the guy, but he is just doing nothing right now on SmackDown. I thought him moving to SmackDown would be so much better for him. I felt like he was lost in the shuffle over on Raw, but it feels like he's lost in the shuffle over on SmackDown too. So I don't mind him losing here and there. The match to Aiden English or the loss to English doesn't necessarily piss me off, but if this keeps happening week after week, I don't want WWE to Dolph Ziggler this guy. I want him to be better than that. So hopefully changes are on the horizon for Sami Zayn. We had Baron Corbin taking on Ty Dillinger. They, of course, had their issue last week when Dillinger tried to answer the U.S. Open challenge by AJ Styles, and Corbin came out and attacked him or whatever. They had the match this week on SmackDown that saw Baron Corbin get the victory after a cheap shot. I think he, like, hit him in the throat or something and then nailed him with End of Days for the win. And AJ Styles was on commentary for this, and I think, did I see this right? I didn't write this down. But in my head, I want to say Ty Dillinger might be getting another shot at the U.S. title very soon. Maybe next week, but that means we're going to have two title matches next week, U.S. title and tag team title. So I don't know if it's coming next week or when. I don't have that written down. So you guys can fill me in on that. I thought there was some sort of backstage segment with AJ and Dillinger, and they were setting up some future match. So I don't have my notes very accurate there, so I apologize. The only other thing I really have written down for SmackDown is that match that Kevin Owens interrupted between Natalya and Carmella did wind up taking place. Natalya beat Carmella when James Ellsworth went to cash in the briefcase for Carmella. She's got Natty down. Ellsworth jumps up on the apron and throws the briefcase in the ring. He's like, hey, cash it in right now. You've got her down. You can win the title right here. And Carmella's like, hell no, what are you doing? Yells at him, and she's all distracted, and that causes her to get rolled up and pinned by Natalya. So eventually, whenever she cashes in this briefcase, Ellsworth is going to be involved. And she's really pissed at him. She cut a promo on him after the match, just completely annihilating him. And then later on backstage, he's trying to ask for her forgiveness, and Carmella plants a very aggressive kiss on James Ellsworth and then slaps the shit out of him. So James Ellsworth finally got that kiss, but he got slapped right after, so I'm not sure if it was worth it or not. But clearly they're setting up something here. When she does finally cash in the briefcase, she might cash it in unsuccessfully, and it might be James Ellsworth's fault if she does. And that could set up a whole nother program between the two. Maybe James Ellsworth can go babyface, maybe the sympathetic babyface like he was before, after she completely breaks his heart and slaps him again, probably, and tells him that he's a piece of shit and pathetic excuse for a human, and all that other stuff she said in the promo on SmackDown. Eventually that will boil over, I would think, and she's going to kick him to the curb. I can't imagine them getting together unless he helps her cash in successfully and she wins the belt, and then she's grateful and she sleeps with him. So I guess it could go one of two ways there. But overall, SmackDown was a pretty good show. I thought it was much better than Raw. And we had the big storyline with Owens and Shane, and their likely Hell in the Cell match at the pay-per-view. We got Vince McMahon coming back next week. Randy Orton and Nakamura had a great main event number one contenders match. So I thought SmackDown was a pretty damn good show this week. Speaking of SmackDown, I don't recall seeing Rusev on the show. He's another guy, much like Dolph Ziggler, that I just don't understand why WWE doesn't want to do anything with these guys. I mean, Rusev is so fucking entertaining. To me, he's better than Ziggler. The fact that WWE does not want to concentrate on this guy, he's a homegrown character and a homegrown talent, exactly what the WWE loves. Got his start in NXT, he's been on the roster having good matches with top guys for the past couple of years, and he's extremely underrated on the mic and with his charisma. We saw some of the things he could do on the Southpaw Regional Wrestling, and he's just overall a really funny guy. And the fact that WWE just refuses to do anything significant with him blows my mind. There must be more going on. We are not backstage. We can bitch and complain about guys not getting opportunities all we want, but we don't really know why. Sometimes it's not as easy as saying, oh, they're a good wrestler, why aren't they doing anything with him? Maybe there's something else we don't know about that they don't like about Rusev. Maybe he pissed him off backstage. He cut his hair, remember? Apparently he got all sorts of heat for that. So maybe if management sours on a guy, regardless of whether it's justified or not, that's going to affect their push, and that's going to affect their status on the roster. So I don't think it's that necessarily WWE thinks Rusev has no talent. I think that they do. I just think that they're pissed at him and they want to fuck with him, and that's what WWE does. If you get on their bad side, they start fucking with you. and it's ridiculous. And there was rumors that Rusev wants his release or has asked for his release. And in my mind, WWE is so big now. There's so many guys on the roster. To deny a man a release who they're doing nothing with, who is fed up with his position there and he's frustrated and he wants to get the hell out, the way WWE has been using him recently, they really wouldn't even know that he's gone. He can go off and work independence or work Japan just like Dolph Ziggler could if he could get a release and maybe be a happier man for it and then maybe return to the WWE some point in the future. But if they're just keeping him there and he's just sitting there in catering, eating sandwiches every week and not being used on TV, and if he is, he's being buried, then just release the fucking guy and give him a break. His wife is there too. Lana is there. She's got some heat. They both have heat. WWE's mad at them for getting engaged, and they're mad at Rusev for getting a fucking haircut. So they seem to just to be pissed at these two for some reason. But that's WWE's own stupidity. That's their loss. If they want to be stupid enough to not use a talented performer like Rusev, then just let him go and be a big star elsewhere, because he definitely could. Rusev has what it takes. He does. And I think we can all agree on that. So I'm furious with the use of Rusev. I'm frustrated. You know, SmackDown has even lost guys recently like John Cena. And SmackDown has also been about giving guys opportunities who have not had those opportunities yet. And I thought Rusev would be right in the middle of the world title mix when he got over to the SmackDown brand. But it has been the exact opposite. And he's been used worse on SmackDown than he was on Raw. And that's saying something. So whatever they wind up doing with Rusev, I just hope they do right by him and stop fucking with his life. Speaking of WWE being assholes, Raw is going to be airing live on Christmas night. Jesus, WWE. And that's not all. Not only on Christmas night, New Year's night. Now, New Year's night, I can understand. That's not a big deal. But Christmas night, I don't know what the fuck the thinking on this is. A lot of people are saying that USA Network wants to have a live show that night, and that's fine. But generally, these Christmas shows are nothing special. They're normally taped. They're normally holiday-themed. Nothing major happens because not a lot of people are watching because they're off doing family stuff or whatever. There's not a lot of eyeballs on the show on those nights, and nothing ever significant happens. So if nothing ever significant happens, why would it kill WWE to tape these shows and give not only their talent, but their employees the night off? I'm not a religious person at all. I'm actually an atheist. But still, the holiday time represents to me personally being with your family, seeing people that you don't get to see very often, spending time with each other. You know, a lot of these wrestlers have families. Some of them are newlyweds. Some of them have young children. And WWE, just do your talent a solid. I've been begging and advocating for an off season for so long. And for years now, and I've always said that the month of December would be a perfect time to do an off season. You could go January to November, balls to the wall, crazy schedules for everybody, and then give all of the talent the entire month of December off. And on Monday Night Raw, maybe run some tape shows, maybe run some best of shows, maybe fly all the talent in on one Monday and do a Slammy Awards like they used to in the banquet hall where everybody's in tuxes and they hand out year-end awards and they do year-end review shows and all that stuff. They could do that throughout the month of December, give all of your talent 30 days off to rest their bones, you know, get over their nagging injuries and start the new year fresh. And I swear it wouldn't affect that much of the WWE's revenue. I know they would lose a lot of ticket sales and they would lose ratings, and there's a lot of money that they would lose there, but I think it would be worth the investment just for the health of your talent and the sanity of your employees and your staff. Just give everybody a breather. You know, some people, when I complained about Raw going live on Christmas Day, they were like, oh, well, the NBA does it and the NFL does it if it falls on a Sunday or whatever. Yes, I understand that. But those guys are making millions and millions and millions of dollars. You give me LeBron money and I will work 366 days a year. And also, those sports have off seasons. You know, it's not the off season during Christmas time for the NBA because that's when their season is. So, yeah, you're going to have some games. Those guys have the whole summer off. They have time to recharge their batteries. You know, same thing with NFL. They have like 8 months of off season. Baseball is off during the holiday season, so they all get to be home with their families. In the WWE's case, when you're working all these dates per year and these guys are never seeing their families and never getting to spend any time with them at all, the holidays are a good time for the talent to be able to do that. And I just wish that WWE would tape Raw on Christmas Day, if it ever falls on a Monday, and just give the wrestlers the night off. Now, this isn't going to happen every year. Raw is only going to fall on Christmas Day, you know, once every few years or whatever. So maybe next year SmackDown will. I'll have to look on the calendar. So if this is something that they feel that they need to do, fine. I just think it's shitty because I think the talent and the employees in WWE are overworked as it is. And whether you are a religious person or not, the holidays should signify a time to be with your loved ones and spend time with them. And like I said, New Year's Day doesn't bother me so much, but Christmas Day does, especially when you think about the wrestlers and their families and the little kids that are involved. I know the Hardy Boys' wives were pissed. I think both Rebby and Jeff's wife tweeted something like, "Thanks for ruining Christmas, WWE." They both have young children, you know, so it's just sad, I guess. You know, it's not something that I'm furious about or anything. It's just something that I think is shitty, and I just wish WWE wouldn't do this stuff, and I just give their guys a break, please. If they are going to have this Raw on Christmas Day, it better be a damn good show. It better not be the same old crappy shit that we see on Thanksgiving episodes or Halloween episodes or any other holiday episodes. You know, there's always the food fight, and there's always the diva match or the women's match with them dressed up as elves or whatever the fuck. They're going to do all that stupid shit on Raw that night. You know that they are. But if they're going to go live on Christmas Day and they're going to promote the shit out of this, they're already telling us this on Twitter in September. So you can only imagine how they are going to ram this down our throats and remind us day after fucking day that Raw is going live on Christmas Day. But I don't think it's going to matter unless they book title matches, unless they make this a pay-per-view quality Raw. Who the fuck's going to watch this show? I'm not. So I just think that WWE, if they're going to continuously tell us about Raw on Christmas Day, then they better make some good matches and do something big. Make it a pay-per-view type deal. You know, maybe take away commercials and just make it a fun night of wrestling for people that want to sit on their couch with their families and watch wrestling. You know, that could be good for them. But if it's just your typical holiday show where nothing happens, I think it's a waste of time to fly everybody in and make everybody work on this day, especially when they could be going head-to-head with Monday Night Football, and there's going to be a shit ton of NBA games on, just like there is every Christmas. There's a lot of sports and a lot of stuff to watch, and the ratings aren't going to be good, I don't think, for this show, unless they do John Cena versus Roman Reigns 2 on this Christmas Day Raw. To me, that's the only thing that'll get fans to tune into this shit. So anyway, a little bit disappointed in the WWE that they just never give their people a break. It just sucks. I have not yet really seen any of the Mae Young Classic, just bits and pieces. I watched a couple of matches. I thought they were good. It was very much like, it had the same feel, I guess, as like the Cruiserweight Classic did and the UK tournament. So I like the idea of having the women's tournament. They're only one round in here. I'm going to start looking at it a little bit more closely now that we're into the second round on the WWE Network. And I'll give some better comments on this once I watch a few more matches and once the winner is declared. And they have that final match. I'll give all of my thoughts on the Classic, but I haven't been paying as much attention to it as I would like, just watching bits and pieces here or there. But so far, all of the reviews from you guys has been pretty good. So if there's any specific matches that you think I should take a look at, let me know in the comments below, and I'll pull it up on the network and take a look. Speaking of the Mae Young Classic, there was some sort of little terrible, horrible, cringy segment that WWE.com released, or it's on their YouTube channel or whatever, and Ronda Rousey was at the Performance Center, or maybe she was there attending the women's tournament, I don't know what the fuck. She was there with two other female wrestlers, and they were approached by Charlotte and Bayley and Becky Lynch, I think, or was it Sasha? I forgot. I think it was Becky Lynch, but it was the most awkward, most horribly acted segment I've ever seen, and it was just weird. And it was basically Ronda Rousey being challenged by Charlotte or the Horsewomen or whatever. So that could be setting up something for Ronda Rousey in the WWE in the future, which is great. I think Ronda Rousey at this point should come to the WWE, and she's probably been training a little bit, and I think a WrestleMania match for Rousey is extremely likely at this point, and I hope that she does come in, because her career in the UFC is most likely over. She's gotten killed in her last two fights, and it's really done a number on her personally. You know, she was very depressed and very down about that, especially after she was so dominant for so long. You know, she got knocked out by Holly Holm, and then when she had her comeback match, she got beat again. So she's probably done with the UFC, and now she can come into the WWE. I think she can transition into a really good female wrestler. She's got a good look, and she's athletic, and she's strong. And with some training, I think she can be really good. So I'm kind of hoping that Ronda Rousey becomes a WWE full-time competitor some point in the future, and I think a match at WrestleMania is pretty likely. I would like to see Charlotte versus Asuka at WrestleMania, but we might get Charlotte versus Rousey, Or Rousey versus Asuka? Who the fuck knows? We could have anything. So even though I'm very happy and pleased with Ronda Rousey's involvement with the WWE, that segment was so bad. I can't believe WWE even posted that shit on Twitter. Reshoot it or do it again or don't post it at all because it looked terrible. And if you haven't seen it, just go on WWE's Twitter page or YouTube or wherever and you'll be able to find it pretty easily. And you can see for yourself how horrible that was. We also have a little bit of Global Force Wrestling news. It was announced earlier this week that Jeff Jarrett is taking a leave of absence from the company to deal with personal issues. Jesus, who knows what the fuck this is. Jeff has probably got something going on. Whether it's family-related or marriage-related or drug-related or whatever, Jeff Jarrett apparently has to leave the promotion to go take care of some stuff, which I wish him the best, but at the same time, come on, Jeff, get your shit together. You're in your 50s. You're an old man now. You're trying to be a promoter. You're trying to be an owner of a wrestling company. You know, start acting like it. Jesus. So whatever your personal issues are, I hope that you get them worked out because now you're not involved with the company that you've started and then left and then started again and then left again, started again. I can't even keep track of how many times Jarrett has been in and out of TNA and Global Force Wrestling. And there's also been rumors that Anthem is already sick of Global Force Wrestling and they've got some buyer's remorse and they might be looking to sell this promotion already. They've only had it for a short time and they might be looking to unload it. So Global Force Wrestling seems like they are just as stable as they always are. There's always some sort of drama going on with them, but I don't know if they will ever go out of business because every time it looks like they are completely destroyed and on the brink of extinction, they somehow survive. They're like the cockroaches of the wrestling business. So if Anthem sells them, they'll probably just sell them to some other company and Global Force Wrestling can live on and can continue drawing 30 to 45 people for their house shows and putting on terrible TV tapings and having women beaters as their champions and all that shit. Just what a mess of a promotion. I don't really wish them ill will. You know, I would like to see them succeed. I think I just get annoyed when they can never have their shit together, ever. There's always some drama going on. Global Force Wrestling, the more they try to bounce around to different networks and different social media platforms and different companies owning them, you get so lost in everything, you don't know what the hell's going on with this company. And I was even reading something about how they're going to start a digital online service, like their own WWE Network type of thing. You know, what are they going to sell that for? $9 or $8.99 or something like that? Maybe a buck cheaper? It just seems like they're in constant turmoil. And I don't know what the hell is going on with them, but now Jeff Jarrett is on the fence with GFW. I'll just sit back and prop my feet up and watch what unfolds with Global Force Wrestling. I really don't care, to be honest with you. I don't watch them. I don't care about them. And even though I would like for them to succeed, it just seems like they never will. So that pretty much wraps it up for this week. I am out of here. I do want to mention last week, I told you guys that Aaron Rift from NoDQ.com invited me on their YouTube channel to do a panel talking about the greatest finishes and wrestling matches in wrestling history. And they finally did release that video. It's up there now. You can click the cards in the right-hand corner of the screen there. I'll have a drop-down menu and you'll be able to see that video there. So click on it and take a look if you want to see me on camera talking about wrestling with three other guys. It was a lot of fun to do that. And I want to apologize because I always kind of forget that Aaron's channel is very family-friendly. And of course, you guys know I drop some F-bombs from time to time, and I tend to curse a little bit. I don't over-curse, but I definitely swear relatively frequently in my commentary. So I do want to apologize for saying fucking shit and damn and hell so many times in that video. But it was still fun to do, and would definitely welcome an opportunity to do that again. And if you guys want to take a look at that, you can click over and watch that. I do have some scheduling issues coming up next week. I should be up here regular time for episode 454. But after that, guess what else is happening to me? On the 18th, which is a Monday Night Raw, I have to move again. Long story short, where I am, I've had a lot of problems with this condo. And I've been complaining a lot. We've had some issues over here. And finally, they have agreed to transfer me over to another property that I like better. And I really didn't want to do it because moving is a pain in the ass. I just moved a year ago, but I'm really getting fed up with living here. So I'm going to stay in the company, but they're going to move me to a different property in another part of town, not very far away, but I have to do that on the 18th. So I should have my internet and everything up and running by the time Raw airs on that Monday. And as far as I know, it should not affect my commentary schedule either. I should be able to come up, even though I'm going to be unpacking and doing a lot of that annoying move stuff. That week's commentary to come on Wednesday, reviewing Raw and SmackDown, which will probably come on the 20th or 21st. That should be on schedule. It shouldn't affect anything at all. If it does, please stay tuned to my Twitter page, at GoodMicWork, and please follow me if you have not yet already, and I will keep you guys updated if in 2 weeks I have any sort of commentary issues or if I have to delay it a day or two because of the move. I will let you guys know. But right now, I'm hoping that I can be up here and the move will not affect anything at all, and most likely it will not even affect my live tweeting on the 18th. Because even though I'll be unpacking and everything, I probably will sit down and watch Monday Night Raw on the 18th and tweet with all of you. So just keep that in mind for the next couple of weeks that I've got that going on. So you guys have a great rest of your week. I should be up here normal time next week. I don't foresee any problems. I shouldn't be late. So check back on the channel late on Wednesday and episode 454 should be up. And like I said, leave me all your comments on everything I talked about in this episode in the comments below. And I look forward to talking to you guys in just a few days. So take care, enjoy your weekend, and I'll talk to you very soon. Until next time, peace.